folks. Welcome inside the Parisi Palace, high above 3733 East Broadway. This is a live edition of the Jake Feinberg Show, coming to you on Power Talk. Please go to our website, powertalk.live. Download our free app and stream all of our live local programming, including Solomon on Blast, the Jim Parisi Show, and yours truly, the Jake Feinberg Show. And we can't thank you enough for making us part of your day today. And one of the reasons I have continued along on this journey, not necessarily following the rules of how other people say life should be led, but rather finding those, the most esoteric, the most gifted geniuses, the ones who are trying to stretch the vocabulary of all musics, is because my guest today is somebody I've been seeking for quite some time. He was a total pioneer of electronic fusion music, played acoustic, post-bop and bebop, came over here to the United States, and has just continued to be an inspiration for so many people, and quite honestly, just is in the pocket of Jake Feinberg. What an honor. Mike Nock, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Hey, thanks, Jake.
How are you, man?
Well, what a rave.
did you recognize that tune we just played?
No, I didn't.
That was off one of my favorite, one of the most mercurial albums, a Mike Nock session entitled Symbiosis, 1967.
Jesus.
Cecil McBee, who I've been honored to interview, Benny Maupin, and Eddie Marshall, Mike Nock. That is a ferocious quartet. And, my question for you, Mike, is could you talk about when you first came to the States, how you would describe the music, melodic improvisation, jazz music at that time? It was not bebop anymore. Some people call it psychedelic jazz. Some people call it, you had Scott LaFaro and Bill Evans talking to each other. You were with Yusef Lateef, and I wanted you to, that early 60s period, pre-Beatles jazz, could you talk about what that music was like?
Well, to be really honest, Jake, I mean, at that period, I didn't think about anything. I was just doing what I always wanted to do, which was play jazz. And I didn't, nowadays, it's a little different because nowadays we're much, there's all these different divisions, like this style and that style and what the hell, But back then, I was just trying to play music.
I dig. No, I mean, I dig, but I mean, you were trying to play music, but was there no terminology? I mean, I still am vexed by the whole idea of where the word even bebop came from. Now we're so stratified, and you have smooth jazz, and you have, R&B festivals that promote that are jazz festivals that only have R&B performers on them. But what you know what it is? It's this. So first of all, did you take a boat over here? Did you take a boat to get here?
Actually, old jokes, I laugh. But you know what? I did take a boat over there.
I bet you did, because I've interviewed.
I actually got to the U.S. by boat, and I got there via England. Literally, I took a boat from Australia to England, and then after a while in England, I caught a boat to the U.S.
So this is so great, because Jan Hammer did that, and so many cats that Alan Broadbent, they all took boats. I know Nock took a boat over here. Let's just focus on this for a minute. I mean, I want to know, what were you doing? What were you marinating on in England? I mean, was it Joe Harriet? Were you playing with Indian tablas? I need to know what you were doing in England.
No, well, what happened is I had this trio. Look, I came from Australia, and I had this trio in Australia that was playing, I would say, a mixture of, it was influenced by a weird mixture Oscar Peterson and Horace Silver and Bobby Timmons. Well, probably more Bobby Timmons.
I love this. Now, what a combination.
Yeah, it was a kind of a, but the thing is, people had never heard music like this, and we were like pop stars at the time. And I said to myself, I was only a kid, I was still 20, wasn't even 21 yet. I said, man, I got to get out of here. because I really wanted to play better. And to me, we were already at the top of the tree down in Australia. And I said, man, I got to go somewhere else where I'm going to get challenged. And that's why I was always had my heart set on going to New York. And I had a little scholarship to the Berklee School of Music. It was worth nothing, but that's all right. It was a reason for me to come to the U.S. And so I just went straight there, and first chance, I was in New York.
In England, so you got to England, and you know, were you playing gigs there? I mean, I've interviewed a lot of.
I had my trio. I had my trio, and that's all I did was play my trio, which I bought from Australia.
Were you playing original Nock compositions? Or are you playing basically stuff from the Oscar Peterson Timmons bag?
Well, would have been playing some of my stuff. Probably the same. You know, it wasn't that different. I would have been playing stuff like Moanin', you know?
Right.
You know, Bobby Timmons, things, shit like that. I mean... It's a long time ago.
Of course, no, but here's, I was born in 1978, so this is like a very important...
Man, you're a baby.
Yeah, I'm a 39-year-old father of two, but, I mean, for me, this period, I get off more on the musicians, I mean, I love the music, but the musicians of that time, your generation, it was paramount. I mean, when you went, it was paramount to feel the music. You had to know how to feel the music. That's why there was moods. I mean, you're playing it's the greatest. When I listen to any of the stuff that you do, it's moody, it's happy, it's lilting, it's bluesy, it's sad. So, like, you didn't have all the technological gadgets, and you had all these places to play, and you had guys like, guys like Ray Santisi and, you know, and people like that over at Berklee. Berklee wasn't, but this is my question for you. How did the vocabulary of music grow so substantially in that 60s period? Because you went to a school of music, but it wasn't like in today's academia where the vocabulary is being grown in academia. I don't really think music can grow in academia.
No, I don't see how it can either. Absolutely. And this is, look, we're living in an age where music is not, doesn't have the same role in society as it did back then. It really wasn't. Look, it was a matter of life and death, even to some of the listeners. Literally. It really meant something to the people back then. And cats would get very partisan about it. Man, you know, like you had to give your all. You know? I mean, it was quite an experience to me. I used to play a lot in Harlem at the famous place.
The Smalls Paradise?
God.
Smalls.
Not Smalls, but maybe it was called Smalls at some point, but the famous place. I just can't think of the name right now.
It's all right, it'll come, yeah.
The real famous place. Not Smalls. Oh, God. My brain.
It was a Club Harlem? Or the Apollo? The Apollo.
Where all the bebop stuff really happened.
Birdland.
Not Birdland. No, this is in Harlem. I'm talking about...
Yeah, no, I mean, dude, I'm totally stumped, dude. I've given you everything I got.
Maybe it was. Well, I don't remember.
All I know is that, like, I mean, like, I mean.
Mint. You know, Minton.
Mintons. Mintons was the bebops? Was
Minton.
That? Wow, okay, cool.
This is like when Mark and all those cats. I mean, I used to play this. You know, it was because I was part of that. I was lucky for some reason. Well, not for the reason being, I was accepted because I wasn't an American, you know. And the cats, I was just part of that scene. I was lucky, you know. I mean, I know I was working with Stanley Turrentine at the beginning, you know. Like, I've done a lot of that stuff, you know. So, and I was traveling with Yusef, you know. I really felt I was in a very special position in the sense that I really kind of, here I am, this white boy, playing the blues. Really steeped in the blues.
Okay, you just said something very, you said you were accepted... Because you were not American.
I think that was it, because, you know, there was a lot of prejudice even in those days, and you know, cliques and all that shit, but I was somehow or other, I was seen as apart from that to the people that knew me. And so the musicians that knew me, I was accepted totally. You know, like, music's always full of cliques. You know what I'm saying? You know, this cat and this cat. But so I was kind of, and listen, the same thing has actually happened here in a different way. But the similar idea, I'm being accepted because I'm not, I'm an outsider, but I'm also an insider, if that makes sense.
But I guess it goes back to, but you, okay, so what year did you come to Berklee?
It would have been 60, 1960.
60. I mean, dude, you have to, I mean, you talk to any cat, any white cats that were playing this music, it was, jazz was a subculture. It was a black, it was a subculture. And that, it didn't really become, you know, white for, you know, till mid to late 70s into the 80s. So, I mean, it was considered to be a major compliment, I'm asking you the question, for a cat like yourself to come in and be able to hang with the jazzers, the African American jazzers, is that right?
I suppose. I mean, I didn't know it as a compliment. It was just a fact of life. You know, I was just accepted. And the thing is, you know, like, I mean, I remember back in Boston, you know, because I used to have to be very tight with Tony Williams, who was a Boston kid too, and Sam Rivers. They were the cats that I used to hang with in Boston. These are the cats I was playing with when I first came to the States, which gave me a different kind of hit. But I was with some cats, you know, I remember like being stopped by the cops, you know, with my friends, with my black friends. And when the cops realized that I was not an American, everything was cool for everybody. You know, it's like, you know, because no one wanted to have any bad publicity.
Wow, you had a lot of, you carried a lot of sway for an Aussie. That's unbelievable. I mean, first of all, you can't.
Well, in today's world, it's a different thing, but back then, you know.
Well, but I mean,
that's what kind of.
I mean, Dennis Bouderer, the guitar player, when he was with Chico, I mean, there were towns they just couldn't stop in. Because of the band and the makeup of the band. But, I mean, at that time, with Tony, you were playing music with Tony Williams in 1960?
Well, not in 1960. That would have been a little later. I mean, because I probably first heard Tony in 60, and wasn't too much later, maybe a year or two later. We were like buddies. This was before I played with Miles. This is like way back when, you know.
Yeah, I mean, what was he, like 10 years old? I mean, how young was he?
No, he was about 16.
He was 16 years old. And so, can you paint the picture of these, how free did the music get? Because Ornette came, actually, this is the question. How impacted were you by Ornette's harmonic theory?
Well, not the harmonic thing as such, but Ornette, yes, definitely. As soon as I heard Ornette, yes, but I didn't know what it was. I never knew what anything was. As a matter of fact, I remember like Hal Galper really getting pissed off at me once in New York many years later because he wanted me to show him what I was doing. You know something? I had no idea what I was doing.
Oh my God! I love it.
He thought I was just, you know, being cool and coy and all that shit. I don't know what I'm just playing from the heart.
Mike Nock, just already blowing my mind. But I mean, this is, so you would say that it was a natural gift, a genius gift, but this idea.
I don't know, genius. It was just, I was just playing music with the cats.
Right, but I mean, but it's one thing to, listen, if you couldn't play, they'd just walk, they'd leave you up on the bandstand by yourself. I mean, you obviously.
Well, that's true.
I mean,
yeah.
You know, I mean, I think how did you. I mean, you came in, did you, you know, so many, I had a chance to interview George Benson earlier this year, and you know, I've done about 5 interviews with Pat Martino, and so it was like, the, you know, the big rivalry was like Willis Jackson versus Jack McDuff, you know, like they had their organ quartets, and so, I mean, did you wind up, I mean, I know Stanley turn team was playing with Shirley Scott. His wife was a B3 player, but were you in that Boogaloo? I know you don't like labels and you're just playing from the heart, but did you find your way into that sort of half jazz, half Boogaloo scene?
No, never. It was always jazz. Even playing with Stan, it was with jazz. We had a jazz quartet. And I was with Stanley because I was a sub for McCoy. I was McCoy's sub. So I got a lot of gigs.
Wow.
Subbing for McCoy.
You were subbing for McCoy and then ultimately
in that band.
In that, and who else was in that group?
Oh my God! I can see his name, a bass player, lovely cat.
Oh, that's okay. The what I'm trying to get at is the idea that you said in the beginning of our show that you had sort of already reached the peak of in your native homeland and as a trio, and that, you know, that you wanted to come stretch out and your dream was to play in New York. And I wonder, was it everything that you expected? Could you talk about what was, if anything, what was surprising to you when you came to New York? Did it meet your expectations? Did it humble you? Because ultimately you had already maxed out in Australia.
No, I was a real arrogant young person. I really was.
And that's why people assumed you were hiding stuff from them when you wouldn't explain stuff, even though you really couldn't explain it.
Yeah, maybe.
Anyway, go ahead. So you were an arrogant guy. You came. Go ahead. I mean, because you wanted to get to New York.
Well, the funny thing was, man, you know, like, I could never understand why the cats would always say to me, "Man, why are you so nervous?" And I'd say, "What do you mean nervous?" I couldn't figure it. I was just, that's how I was. I was this ball of energy.
Yeah, no, I did. I dig it. I really do. I mean, can you ultimately? You wound up like Youssef was out of Detroit, so I'm trying to figure out how you ultimately. Those early albums, you know, that was seminal work. I mean, you're talking about Live at Pep's Volume 2. I mean, can you talk to the audience a little bit about when you're playing with these, the heaviest cats, the experience, because like you said, you can't explain it, and it's a natural thing, and it's not like, can you talk about the transcendent quality of spiritual music and a time early in your career when you left your physical body on the bandstand?
Quite often. Well, look, but it was, you know, I mean, this went back to when I first started playing. Before I knew anything, back in New Zealand, I used to be able to sit at the piano, and I would get transported. I had no idea what I was doing. I would just get transported, literally. And the thing is, the more I learned, that started happening less. But that's so. It's basically from the whole thing that makes the church music. But I'm not a church person in that sense. But you know, like it was. So it was from the same impulse, though. I always, when I was a kid, I used to imagine myself in a room with all these heavy cats. Just as a kid, I'd imagine they were listening to me play. I just did. I don't know why. You know, it is a spiritual thing in the sense that it touches another dimension. The music does touch another dimension, and I do find that today's younger musicians, the cats I know, it's more intellectual than anything. And I hear the music. I'm always listening to stuff and playing with young cats and all that stuff, or younger cats. But to me, the big thing that I miss is that spiritual dimension. That's what it was all about to me and my friends.
I love this. Okay, so this is this is so important. Can you go unpack? I mean, you had a band called The Fourth Way. there was a...
Well, that was a little later.
That was later. That was no, that absolutely... but I want to go deeper with this because this is so important for younger... What is the... Tell me a little bit, as best you can, about accessing this other dimension. Because a lot of my show is based in the metaphysical, and it was, I think it was Monty Alexander told me, he's like, you know, dude, they've intellectualized everything to the point you don't even know what jazz is anymore, when it was just more a raw, melodic, improvisatory music. So if you can go deeper on that prism, that new dimension, that other dimension that you were consistently accessing, I would love that.
Well, you know, I mean, it was just, it wasn't intellectual, okay, as we just said. For me, I was just really immersed in a different universe. I mean, one thing what happened back in those days, before I even got to New York and that, it's like, I mean, Bob Moses just came to stay with me, you know, like about a year ago or less, you know. He was part of that scene. We used to just go and play. This is in New York, you know, with Jim Pepper and people like that.
Well, the Free Spirits, yeah.
Well, we used to just jam. This was back before. This is actually maybe at the same time as the Free Spirits or before them or whatever. But we were just playing. And we used to travel to the cosmos. I'm telling you. We physically would be in, you know, talk about Sun Ra. Man, you think I'm being silly, maybe. But we really did. We really actually thought, anyway, that we were space travelers.
No, I really don't think you're being. This is why I've been wanting to talk to you for so long, is because this is what's happened. I mean, you can talk about the intellectualization of jazz getting to the point where you lost the blue collar cats. They stopped being able to tap their feet to it. But this is what we're talking about right now with Mike Nock, is a completely separate portal. Where you guys basically, I mean, was it about taking a standard tune and then going off into a different vector? Or was this just, just sort of saying, with Rock Alarm, with Bob Moses and Pepper and, you know, Coryell and these guys, they were, at least Coryell, I mean, they were really... dabbling with psychedelics. They were doing a lot of drugs. So a lot of people would say, you know, you could go. But at the same time, I've talked to a number of cats who played this spiritual, new dimensional music, and they never had a drug in their life. So it was something about this communal communication and I guess ultimately it was your ears. Your ears were just wide open, and your listening skills. I mean,
well, it's the ears are wide open, but it's also... You know, you talk about drugs and stuff. I mean, you know, I was into the drugs also. But the point is, it happens by osmosis, not by drugs. You're around people that are seeing or experiencing certain things. You start experiencing them if you're open. You know what I mean?
Well, I mean, dude, when I hear you playing in a certain pocket of time, which, I mean, every album, live or in the studio, it always is exciting because you do start to take off. I mean, you just start to rip, and it's like the most intoxicating. In fact, you know, we can just talk in the abstract, but let's take a listen to this piece of music, and then we'll come back and talk about it, okay?
Thank you.
All right, brother Mike Nock, what do you got for us? What do you think that is?
I've got no idea. Who is that?
That was you, my friend. Live performance from, please don't space out on this, Jake. It was actually a folk club in Southern California with John Klemmer, Eddie Marshall.
Oh, shit.
And Wilton, Wilton Felder. It was on an album called Waterfalls. It was at the Ash Grove. The Ash Grove was like a place where like Scotty Stoneman, who was like this fiddle player with no, it was like a bluegrass place. But then they know, like early 70s, anything goes. Victor Feldman on percussion, Mike Nock. This, I mean, I got to tell you, I walked these hills in my neighborhood in Tucson, and for several years, these tunes, there's a couple, there's the Centrifugal Force is another one, and this one was called There's Some Light Ahead. You're playing on it is burning. It's just burning to the skulls of the beyond the rafters, beyond the cosmos. And it, you know, to me it was like there's a magic there. And I want to go back to something you said before. You said it was a matter of life and death, even for some patrons. Did you witness people go to Did you witness people go to blows at Minton's over music? I mean, what did you mean by that?
It really was. Look, it was a different. You know, you got to understand that it was a different society, and so music, to many people, you know, to many. Particularly people, particularly a lot of the more disadvantaged people in this society, you know,
yes,
particularly
yeah.
Black people, it was their whole fucking life. It was their life. The music was their life. It really meant that much to them because it really was amazing. And so I didn't consciously think like this, but that's how I thought. I was also like that from a different perspective, I guess. I was just... So, like, it's funny because you just played me and I didn't know who that is. You know, that's been happening to me a lot lately. People have been playing me early records I've done and said, "Who's that?" And I don't know who the hell it is. And it's me. I can't believe it. Wow. Like, Gene Perla sent me something from the U.S., you know, the bass player.
Oh, yeah.
Gene Perla. He sent me a track. But he didn't say who it was. And I'm digging it. Man, this is great. Finally, I get back and say, "Man, you know, it's fantastic. But what is it?" He said, "Man, it's you." I said, "What?"
Yeah, because were you part of that class with Perla, the first Berklee class?
Yeah.
It was I think Ernie Watts, Dick Burke. Who else was in that original group? Alan Broadbent? I'm not sure.
Well, no, not Alan. I didn't really know Alan. I mean, you know, back in those days, I had to be scratching my brain. Oh, a guy called, I remember a few people, Dusko Gojkovic, trumpet player from Europe.
Wow.
Has he ever been, he was quite a big star. Dusko Gojkovic, I'm trying to think of some other people that you might know.
I want to go back. This, you said something really interesting. I mean, you're telling me that it was an outlet of expression for African Americans, and therefore... That sort of urgency, that desperate edge, rubbed off on you, and you wanted to be played just like that. I'm trying to understand.
No, Jake, I had that anyway.
You had it anyway.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, I had that anyway. I mean, it just kind of, it was able to flourish. It was like, oh man, I'm home. When I came to the U.S., it was like, yeah. I'm part of that, you know. I just without consciously trying to, that just was, hey, a recognition of family. And that's the thing that I've always felt about the Black community in those days. It did change. I saw it changing, but that's what it was, and I was accepted into that family. That was the thing.
Did you?
You know, that's something.
Yeah.
And that's something I don't get so much nowadays at all, unless it's from cats that from that era.
The problem also is that, like, there's no real, I mean, in the States at that time, there was an incredible touring circuit. I mean, were you winding up staying at people's houses, like Youssef's house? I mean, because a lot of times, like, Ellis Marsalis, you know, when he was in a band with a guy you probably played free with, which was Lee Charlton, the drummer, when they were...
All right!
You know, Lee was telling me that, like, you know, driving through Texas... And they'd stop at a hotel in the white part of town, and Ellis couldn't stay with them. So they'd have to drive Ellis to a black, you know, did that, can you talk about, when you talk about that community being embraced, when you would go on the road to Philly, Detroit, were you winding, staying up with the, were you staying at these people's houses?
No, I always stayed with the cats. No, I didn't experience that. Although I did experience elements of that, you know, like I remember once when we were driving back from, San Francisco. We were driving back from the West Coast, and we had to go through somewhere, Colorado maybe?
Right.
And with Youssef, and we had Johnny Coles in the band, who had that pigment disease.
Yes.
So he looked kind of weird. And a drummer called James Black, who was kind of really weird looking.
Dude, James Black was on drums?
James Black.
That dude played with Ellis, man. He was from New Orleans.
I know.
Oh my God, that dude was a ridiculous drummer. So anyway, yeah, you had Coles with the pigment. Continue.
So what happened is we got to this little one road town in the middle of nowhere, and it was early in the morning, and we had to get some breakfast. So we go to this place to get some breakfast, and man, we're like aliens. People are looking at us, and the vibe was horrible, you know. So, but we had a problem with the car. And we had to get the car fixed. We were all riding in this car, and so we take it to the local garage, and they had to get a part from San Francisco, and the part never arrived. And it's getting weird now. People are coming from all over to kind of look at us, and it's starting to snow, and it's like, fuck, man, it was really getting, you know, one of those weird times.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah. This is insane. How many days were you there? There was no way they were going to overnight apart.
No, we were just there for the one day. But it was real scary. And so, what happened is Yusuf decided. Well, we're better just kind of just try and see whether we can get to the next town because this was getting weird. You know, there wouldn't have been any place for us to stay. I'll tell you something.
And it was starting to snow. So, I mean, this is unbelievable.
And so we started driving. And man, these cats came after us in their pickup trucks and shit, trying to bump us off the road and shit. It was out. It was really out.
Wow. Wow. But, you know, wow.
And we were nervous. We were nervous that the car was going to break down, you know, in the middle of nowhere.
I've heard stories about, I mean, do you think it was Ku Klux Klan kind of people?
That kind of thing.
No, you know, I didn't phrase my question well. I wanted you to talk about staying with the black community. What it was truly about. Forget the racism and the bigotry and the cultural bias. The idea that going to Detroit and being immersed in that, in those homes, and being welcomed into those homes in a trusting way. And to me, that's probably the most beautiful thing about your career is the fact that you were able to cross over and play with the cats and play with all the cats. I mean, that to me is special. And so, you know, when you would go to Detroit, you'd wind up crashing at Youssef's house or, you know, that kind of stuff?
No, I was always in a hotel. You know, but it was cool. I mean, but I must admit, I was different. I was different to the rest of the cats, you know, like, I mean, it was, there was, like, even, like, I worked with Art Blakey once, you know.
Wow.
And what happened, we ended up in the airport, and Art was, I only played one gig with Art, you know, at that time, you know, and Art was, like, stuck to me like he was so close to me because... It was very weird. He just wanted to be, I think he just wanted to be around the, you know, have a white cat on his side.
Wow.
You know?
Wow.
It was a very different period, you know?
Well, it was different, and yet, Oh, God, so much stuff is flooding into my head right now. I want you to talk about, you know, George Duke had a band with James Leary called The Third Wave.
I seem to remember that now.
Yeah, they had some Filipino singers, and but I wanted you, you know, for the record, because I have all the vinyl, including the live album. Could you talk about the conceptually what you guys were trying to do with the Fourth Way, insofar as stretching the vocabulary of music? And I know you're going to come back and say, well, we didn't have any plans. It was all, there was no plan. But I mean, when you put...
Well, you're right.
No, but when you put violin, when you put Michael White and Eddie Marshall, maybe the greatest drummer in the history of the world, and, you know, Ron McClure and yourself, that's an odd quartet. So, I mean, can you just talk about... And it was, and at the time, it was very progressive. I mean, it was very new. So I just was hoping you could talk a little bit about, in looking back on it, what that band signified.
Well, it didn't signify much, except it was like me and Michael White were friends, and we'd often talked about playing together. Okay,
right.
But that was the basis of that. You know, we got to get a band together. And I was out in California with Dionne Warwick. I was touring with Dionne, you know. And then I got Eddie Marshall on that band, you know, because I really wanted Eddie to play drums with me and Mike. And our very first bass player was James Leary.
That's right. That is right. That is right.
Well, that's right. I was there.
But he didn't. Once you started cutting albums for Capitol, he was not there. It was all McClure on those.
Well, I'm not sure what happened there. I really don't know what that was all about. I mean, I don't. You know, I don't remember. But it turned out that Ron. Oh, I know. We played a gig opposite Charles Lloyd. And Ron was on the gig, and somehow or other, we just all kind of just wanted Ron in the band for some reason. I don't know why we didn't stay with James, because, I mean, I love James. I don't know what happened, but anyway, maybe James wasn't available. And Ron, I think Ron was quitting Charles Lloyd at the time or something.
Right. So, I mean, when you and Mike would talk about wanting to play together, I mean, what does the Fourth Way mean?
Well, the Fourth Way is from that philosophy, the Gurdjieff philosophy. And actually, it really had nothing to do with Gurdjieff.
Right, exactly. That's exactly right.
But the thing is, we were kind of, as you said, spiritually interested in all kinds of things. You know, in our own way, it kind of meant something to us. But also, I like the idea of the fact that there's four of us, you know, and I love the whole idea of fourth in music. That was my whole thing. I was trying to, you know, I loved the idea of instead of having a tertiary based harmony, I was really interested in a fourth based harmony. I never got into it as much as I'd like, but these are things that are in your brain, you're thinking of, you know. And the Fourth Way just made so much sense, you know.
You are such a modest, you are so humble. I mean, the fourth, what do you say, fourth what? You're a fourth harmony? You're already interested in what?
Well, just fourth. Yeah, I was just interested in the whole, because fourth as a basis for harmony tend to make it more freer. It tend to make it freer, the whole fourth concept, you know. It was just something that I was kind of, you know, we had our own ideas, you know, we followed our own ideas.
Exactly. I know, you know, and there wasn't a Mike Nock a book out on theory. I wanted you to talk about the idea of the Mike Nock concept, because I often, with, you know, I'm 39, getting older by the day, but there are younger cats, my daughters included, you know, they're very caught up in electronic music, looped music, music in 4/4 time. Everybody's very much preoccupied in the live setting about where's the one, where's the one, where's the one. And like James Jamerson used to say, any note can be the one. And I wanted you to talk about the Mike Nock concept of any note can be the one.
Well, again, it's not an intellectual concept. I think it's just a way of embracing everything.
I dig.
You know, it really is.
But I mean, okay, so then put it into the I'm obsessed with all these drummers like Eddie Marshall. How did you guys, like, when you lose that one and collectively all come back in at the same time, that's a spiritual thing. That's one of those things where that's beyond the music. And that's all I'm searching for is that, thank God you guys are still here to drop some knowledge, because it's really important. Like you said, you play with a lot of younger cats now, and you can't access, not all the time, but you can't access that dimension. And I guess I want to explore with you the ideas. What are your ideas to strip away this saturation of material so that people can, if they are seekers and they are kind of eccentric cats like me and you are, that how they can find, how they can search for that dimension and eventually access it?
Well, it's a very interesting question on many levels. And I think today we have too much information. Everything is gone this way now. I'm so busy, for instance, here in Sydney. What do I do? You open the computer or something, or your internet. There's all this information. We're flooded by information, flooded by it on every level. It wasn't like that back then. There was not that access to stuff. And I think that was great. You had to search for things. You had to look out things. If you wanted to find out something, you didn't look on the internet. You had to find a book. You had to find someone that knew something about it. You know. However misconstrued it might have been, you still had to find something. You had to search. People often ask me these questions, you know, what was I thinking about? Man, I wasn't thinking. You know, I was just doing, you know.
Can you give an example? Can you give an example where, you know, meaning today, well, today somebody would automatically open up and be deluged by my material versus just doing it? Can you give an example?
Well, yeah, it's like, but back then it was like, as I said, the same thing that Hal said to me, man, he thought I was hiding something from him. It was, man, you listen, you just listen to the music and you respond. And in doing so, intuitively, you find places. You go to places.
That takes it, but you're talking about very simply is trust on the bandstand. And because you
exactly.
and but you
exactly.
guys you guys had six nights a week, three four weeks a month at the same place to get comfortable. Younger cats don't develop that trust because there's not enough places to play anymore, to get your own individual sound, to fall on your face, to make mistakes. Trust on the bandstand. That's what I believe accesses that dimension. But if you don't get enough live opportunities to play and get comfortable as a group. And, you know, that's what the crisis we're facing in this country is, a supply and demand. People like Hal Galper, they're cranking out these technical monsters, and they got no place to play.
Yeah. No, exactly.
The other,
but it's no better nowadays here. Like, I mean, it's pretty rough, but you've found yourself, it's about people, it's about souls, spirits maybe, or whatever. You find yourself with people, and you kind of spend time with people, the people that you choose, you know, and you just keep doing your thing, whatever, you know, and it shapes the music. It's still like that with me, even here in Australia.
No, I can feel that, and I can hear that. I know that is. I'm curious if you sought out any sanctified churches in the States where you saw the spirit, the language of the drum, the rhythm, and maybe that was already present when you were before you came to the States. But you know, being that you were in New York, did you play with Dion? Not exactly a gospel soul singer, but did you find yourself ever in a sanctified church?
Well, Well, no, but when I lived in San Francisco, literally every Sunday morning, I was living in a place, a 400-room abandoned hotel called the Reno Hotel, that you may have read about.
No, I haven't. This is awesome. Oh, my God. Yeah.
The Reno. That's where I lived. I mean, you know, and me and my girlfriend at the time, we had this big space, this huge space, and the separated space was a gospel church, you know, that every Sunday morning I'd wake up, and the only thing dividing me from the church was this piece of plasterboard, and I'd hear the guy saying, "I feel good."
Wait, hold on. In the abandoned hotel was Mike Nock's residency, and then also a gospel church within the same hotel.
I'm telling you, man.
We're gonna have to do part two because I got to go pick up my younger daughter. But as we wrap up set one here, I wanted you to. This is extremely important. Can you talk about, it could be Eddie Marshall. Ultimately, I'm obsessed with, you know, you go back in the lineage and you go to Kenny Clark, you go to Max Roach, you go to people like that. In today's contemporary music paradigm, the bass drums are used as the primary timekeeper. But when you were coming up in the, you know, and even when you got your career off the ground and you were playing with guys like, you know, James Black and Eddie Marshall, they were not using the bass drum as the primary timekeeper. They might use it as an accent or for rebound, but I kind of wanted you to talk about what made Eddie Marshall just a great drummer and how he used the cymbals to keep time.
Well, I'll tell you something about Eddie. Eddie was a great piano player.
And recorder. He could play the recorder.
Yes, exactly. He played a wonderful recorder. So that really affected, and to me, he understood. And you know how come he understood? Because his dad was a piano player. Either his dad was either a piano player or a drummer. I'm not sure. But anyway, they used to play together. And Eddie found out. Oh, Eddie was a piano player. That's what, playing with his dad. He was a drummer. And he knew how it felt when the drums didn't feel right. He knew how to make the drums feel a certain way. And that's what he always did. That's why I loved playing with Eddie right from the get-go, you know, because he had that thing. He danced.
Mike Nock,
he did.
You know, I mean, it is 6:07 in the morning. Can we do a part two? I have so much more to talk to you about, but you just kind of, you kind of blew my mind, dude. I mean, I'm sort of like, I'm not angry like Hal Galper, but you know, I don't want you holding back anything from me. You know, we need this stuff, you know. Much love to you, man. Thank you. I'm going to get you, I'll get this copy out, and I'll be transcribing some of the pertinent stories. And much love to you, Nock. We'll set up part two real soon.
Thanks, Jake. Great to talk to you.
Cheers, brother.
Thanks, mate.
Later on. Just another day here on the Jake Feinberg Show on Power Talk. Heard from Buzz Fighting in set one, and just heard from the legendary pianist Mike Nock. We'll be off for a couple weeks. We'll be in tomorrow for a couple of live Facebook video shoots. Going to be hot in here tomorrow. Until then, this is the Jake Feinberg Show. We'll see you later.